Street, if that makes sense. And you know, in your situation, like in the psychological aspect, you know, and I know that guys like that are dropping up when we end up trying to read their lives. And that would be part of his frustration. But if you look at New York, my thing would be, if he still won a championship out there or even have a lot of success, he would be capitulated on every single thing they wanted of this season. And I think Anthony Davidson bears that out, because obviously I think if Rick Paul was the GM, that, you know, obviously LeBron's agent and also Anthony Davidson's agent, then, you know, they would have found a way to get happy with us. Now, they couldn't control the way that New Orleans handled the situation. I understand that. But even the coaching stuff, some of that stuff is real when it comes to, and I'm not going to speak for LeBron, but people around him, certainly not maybe having the highest view of Walton, but sure, you know, he's still the coach. Just last night, Josh Lincoln said he was doing an amazing job. So they tried to kind of keep a little bit of a distance between the front office and their franchise centerpiece. But it is tricky. And, you know, I don't know where it's all going. This is maybe a longer conversation, but I really think after them missing out on AD, you know, there is a scenario here where I'd be pretty serious to suspect to get the second start. But if you play out all the scenarios, I can't find one right now that really points in the Lakers' favor.
Yeah, we've seen a scenario, we've seen this trip before, where LeBron comes to town, changes coaches, and then gets rid of players. So none of these Laker players can be, I don't think, surprised by it. They might be disappointed, but they should have read the script that's been written a couple of times here. And I'm with you. I think Luke is on numbered days here, and you know, these younger players as well, and they realize that their time is probably short. But what's the Pelicans game plan now over the next, you know, 3, 4, 5 months?
They are, first and foremost, I think, the dead down for GM, Mickey Loomis, is, you know, this part, yeah, he's a close GM, and he also, technically speaking, oversees the basketball operations group for the Pelicans. They, I guarantee you, are now just hoping and praying that Danny Ainge and the Celtics meant, you know, everything they said during these past couple weeks. The way I was told is that, and this is a pretty unique situation, because the Celtics couldn't trade for Anthony right now, and they can't until July because of the stipulation in the CBA, until Kyrie Irving was a free agent, they couldn't touch AD. They had to have these informal talks where you kind of set the stage for more talks this summer and give indications about what sort of package might be available for you at that time. And, you know, I was told that Jason Tatum's name was definitely discussed, and not promised by anything, but discussed. And so if you're the Pelicans, I think that is the best package that you cannot predict. Nobody is more cunning than Danny Ainge. And so I think, you know, now the question becomes, you know, what does Danny actually put on the table in late June, you know, when you're talking about this thing for real? So Boston's front and center. You probably revisit the Lakers thing at that point. The Clippers are going to put a package out in front of New Orleans. And the draft lottery comes into play here big time as well, because the Knicks, probably more than anybody, are hoping they can get that number one pick. And if they did, you know, and the odds are not great at 14%, then, you know, they'd be in that AD game too. So yeah, it's uncomfortable in New Orleans right now, but I think this is why there was a major advantage for waiting until this time.
The best rumor that you heard that didn't come through?
Probably Mike Conley to Indiana. We wanted to go to Camp Roman. The poor guy has played all-star caliber level basketball for his entire career, but he's in the West, and this is the land of Steph Curry and James Harden, Westbrook, Chris Paul. And so I know Mike has pushed back on this idea publicly, but it did certainly seem like there were pretty strong indications given to the Grizzlies that he wanted to play in the East. And so the Pacers thing looked like a real possibility. I was told that it got pretty far down the road, and they just couldn't get it over the finish line. And that would have been one where, you know, we continue to overlook Indiana. I mean, they're right there with the best of the best in the East, and Victor Oladipo being on the shelf. You know, Mike could have come in there, and I think been a little bit of a savior. I think that would have been a great fit, but they just couldn't get it done.
And great stuff. Always great to talk to you. Appreciate your time. Thank you.
Likewise, Dan. Thank you.
That's Sam Amick, the NBA senior writer at The Athletic. Yeah, the Clippers, you know, once again, Jerry West is there. And when they traded Tobias Harris, who I really love, and I thought it was a great pickup by the 76ers, sometimes you look at the shiny object in front of you instead of looking at, wait, what's going on over here? And I do think it's a foregone conclusion that Kevin Durant is gone. And Kevin Durant, I know that he blames the media. We make more out of it. We're always asking questions. Well, he's the one that created this. He could have signed a 3-year deal with Golden State. And then there is no issue here. Nobody's asking him any questions. So he's part of it. The same thing with Kyrie. You know, Kyrie said, well, if they'll have me, I'll go back to Boston. And then all of a sudden, he's like, I'm not sure what I'm doing here. And then all of a sudden, he's yelling at his teammates. I'm like, they're helping create this. Do we stir it up? Yes. Because we want something to be there. But, you know, we didn't all of a sudden say, you know what, let's create some Kevin Durant drama or Kyrie Irving. That didn't happen. Hey, let's create some drama. LeBron's going to trade all of the young kids on the team.
Yeah. But, like, the picture of LeBron sitting on the bench all by himself is a perfectly created media story. That's absolute nonsense. The two players that were sitting next to him stepped into the game about 5 seconds before that picture was taken. And that whole thing is a complete, it's a farce. It's not at all what happened. But it's just a fun-looking picture.
But you don't think it's a metaphor for exactly what is going to happen? I'm all the way. Okay, so you can say, all right, yeah, I hate these kids, but, you know, could you have just gotten? I've been on the bench. I've been on the bench, you know, a lot.
So they get up and then go, LeBron has to keep shuffling chairs every time somebody checks in the game.
No, no, he could have.
So the optics don't look bad.
He could have moved up towards coach. You know, you could just sit next to the coach. I think there's more to that. Even though he was away from his team, I think it does say a lot about that. That's really what that team is. It's LeBron and then those guys who used to be, you know, with the Lakers, in my opinion. But, you know, we've seen this. LeBron, I think, was trying to get Spoelstra out in Miami. Remember when they had that little, he walked by and he, like,